Simon & Schuster Audio presents American Like Me, Reflections on Life Between Cultures, edited by America Ferrera with E. Casey Dumont, with an introduction and conclusion written and read by America Ferrera. Contributions by Uzo Aduba, Anna Akana, Bambadjan Bamba, Carmen Carrera, Joaquin Castro, Joy Cho, Auli'I Cravalho, America Ferrera, Roxanne Gay, Diane Guerrero, Lori Hernandez, Angela Johnson Reyes, Liza Koshi, Michelle Kwan, Padma Lakshmi, Jeremy Lin, Al Madrigal, Lin-Manuel Miranda, Kumail Nanjiani, Randall Park, Ravi Patel, Cal Pin, Carmen Perez, Issa Ray, Gina Rocero, Linda Sarsour, Reshma Sajani, Martin Sensmeier, Wilmer Valderrama, Frank Wan, Tanaya Winder, and Jenny Zhang. Read by Bambadjan Bamba, Joy Cho, Auli'I Cravalho, Tim Chu, Janina Edwards, America Ferrera, Jennifer Ikeda, Lameece Issaq, Eugene Kim, Jennifer Lim, Sunil Malhotra, Ramón de Ocampo, Roxana Ortega, Geena Rocero, Martin Sensmeier, Heather Alicia Sims, Neela Vaswani, and Tanaya Winder.
Introduction. America Ferrera. My name is America, and at 9 years old, I hate my name. Not because I hate my country, no. In fact, at 9 years old, I love my country. When the national anthem plays, I cry into my Dodger dog thinking about how lucky I am to live in the only nation in the world where someone like me will grow up to be the first girl to play for the Dodgers. I do hate the Pledge of Allegiance, though. Not because I don't believe in it. I believe every word of it, especially the liberty and justice for all part. I believe the Pledge of Allegiance to my bones, and at 9 years old, I feel honored, self-righteous, and quite smug that I was smart enough to be born in the one country in the whole world that stands for the things my little heart knows to be true. We are all the same and deserve an equal shot at life, liberty, and a place on the Dodgers batting lineup. I hate the Pledge of Allegiance because for as long as I can remember, there is always at least one smartass in class who turns to face me with his hand over his heart to recite it. You know, because my name is America. The first day of every school year is always hell. Teachers always make a big deal of my name in front of the whole class. They either think it's a typo and want to know what my real name is, or they want to know how to pronounce it. Ridiculous, I know. And they always follow up with, America? You mean like the country? Yes, like the country, I say, with my eyes on my desk and my skin burning hot. This is how I come to hate American history. Not because I don't love saying the Battle of Ticonderoga, obviously I do, but because no teacher has ever been more excited to meet a student named America than my first American history teacher. He has been waiting all day to meet me, and so to commemorate this moment, he wheels me around the classroom on his fancy teacher's chair, belting God Bless America, while a small part of me dies inside. His face reminds me of Eeyore's when I say, actually, I like to go by my middle name, Georgina, so could you please make a note of it on the roster paper thingy, thanks. When he has the gall to ask me why, I say something like, it's just easier, instead of what I really want to say, which is, because people like you make my name unbearably embarrassing. And another thing, I'm not actually named after the United States of America. I'm named after my mother, who was born and raised in Honduras. That's in Central America, in case you've never heard of it. Also part of the Americas. And if you must know, she was born on an obscure holiday called Día de las Américas, which not even people in Honduras know that much about. but my grandfather was a librarian and knew weird shit like that. This is a holiday that celebrates all of the Americas, South, Central, and North, not just the United States of. So, my name has nothing to do with amber waves of grain, purple mountains, the U.S. flag, or your very narrow definition of the word. It's my mother's name, and a word that also relates to other countries, like the one my parents come from. So please refrain from limiting the meaning of my name, erasing my family's history, and making me the least popular kid in class all in one fell swoop. Just call me Georgina, please. I don't say any of this to anyone, ever. It would be impolite or worse, unpatriotic. And as I said before, I love my country in the most unironic and earnest way anyone can love anything. I know just how lucky I am to be an American because every time I complain about too much homework, my mother reminds me that in Honduras, I'd be working to help support the family. So I'd better thank my lucky stars that she sacrificed everything she had so that my malcriada self and my five siblings could one day have too much homework. It's a perspective that has me embracing Little League Baseball, the 4th of July, and ABC's TGIF lineup of wholesome American family comedies with more fervor than most. I feel more American than Balky Bartokomis, the Winslows, and the Tanners combined. And I believe that one day I will grow up to look like Aunt Becky from Full House, and then Frank Sinatra will ask me to re-record I've Got You Under My Skin as a duet with him because I know all the words better than my siblings. So I let it slide when people respond to my name with, "Wow, your parents must be very patriotic. Where are they actually from?" This is a refrain I hear often and one that will take me a couple of decades to unpack for all its implications and assumptions. I learned to go along with the casting of my parents as the poor immigrants yearning to breathe free who made it to the promised land and decided to name their American daughter after the soil that would fulfill all their dreams. After all, it is a beautiful and endearing tale. Only later do I learn to bristle and push back against this incomplete narrative. A narrative which manages to erase my parents' history, true experience, and claim to the name America long before they had a U.S.-born child. Never mind that they already had a U.S.-born child before me and named her Jennifer, which is both a much more American name than mine and one I would kill to have on the first day of every school year. But I am 9, and I do not think too much about narratives and my parents' erased history. I think about my friends and getting to go over to their houses where we play their brand new Mall Madness board game and search Disney movies for the secret sex images you can see if you know where to pause the VHS. I think about how cool it would be if my mom ever let me actually sleep over at a friend's house and how that will never happen because she's convinced all sleepovers end in murder and sexual assault. I think about how cool it would be if my friend was allowed to sleep over at my house and how that will never happen because her parents, who are also immigrants, happen to agree with my mom about the murder and sexual assault thing. I think about how when I'm in junior high and look more like Aunt Becky, I will have a locker and decorate it with mirrors and magazine cutouts like all the kids on Saved by the Bell. I think about how I will grow up to be a professional baseball player, actress, civil rights lawyer, and veterinarian who will let her kids go to sleepovers. And I think about boys. Well, I think about one boy. A lot. Aside from having a challenging name, I feel just like all my friends. Even all the things that make my home life different from my friends' home lives seem to unify our experience. Sure, my parents speak Spanish at home, but Grace's parents speak Chinese, and Muhammad's parents speak another distinct language that I can't name, and Brianne's Filipino parents speak something that sounds a little like Spanish, but isn't. My favorite part of going over to my friends' houses is hearing their parents yell at them in different languages and eating whatever their family considers an after-school snack. Brianne and I consume an alarming amount of white rice soaked in soy sauce while we stretch in the dark listening to her mom's Mariah Carey album. Speaking Spanish at home, my mom's Saturday morning salsa dance party in the kitchen, and eating tamales alongside apple pie at Christmas do not in any way seem at odds with my American identity. In fact, having parents with deep ties to another country and culture feels part and parcel of being an American. I am 9, and I truly belong. By the time I reach 10, this all begins to change. The first person to make me feel like a stranger in a strange land is the first boy I ever love. I am 6 years old when I fall in love with Sam Spencer, and the full agony of loving him is bursting out of my tiny bones and pulsing through my tiny veins. He has very silky, soft brown hair that is almost entirely short except for the rat's tail that dangles down the nape of his neck. I sit behind Sam on the magic carpet at reading time, and I try to be sneaky about braiding his rat's tail. Whether we are making pizza bagels or building castles in the sandbox, all my little six-year-old mind can focus on during Miss Wildstein's kindergarten class is braiding Sam's hair, talking to Sam, and sitting near Sam. With every passing year, new boys and girls are added to our class, but my heart remains fully devoted to worshiping at the altar of Sam Spencer. By the time we are in third grade, I am aware that other girls also think Sam is one of the cute boys. But I am secure in the deep foundation we have built starting back in kindergarten. When I sit next to him at lunch, he does not tell me to go away, and that has to mean something. I don't need to tell him I love him or need him to declare his love for me. I just need to sit next to him on the reading carpet and stand as close to him in the lunch line as possible. I'm fulfilled with making him laugh from across the classroom by taking my long brown hair and turning it into a mustache and beard on my face. I think of him as mine because my heart says he is. What more proof do I need? I never imagined that our relationship will ever need to be spoken about. One day, we, the students of Ms. Kalachek's third grade class, are lined up after lunch. I am locking arms and stifling giggles with my girlfriends Jenna and Allison when Sam taps my shoulder. This is unusual. He is not often the initiator of our conversations. I turn to him very attentively and wait. He opens his mouth to say, "I like Jenna more than you. Do you want to know why?" The masochist in me answers too quickly, "Why?" He says,
"We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description."